Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Time for us to begin this morning. Appreciate everyone being here. If you're visiting with us, we certainly appreciate your presence. We hope you will take just a moment afterwards and let us know how much we appreciate you being here. As we begin this morning, I'd like a couple of things I'd like to share with you. Isaiah 26:4 tells us, "Trust in the Lord always, for the Lord God is the eternal rock." My personal version of this verse says, "Trust in the Lord always, for the Lord is my eternal rock." My normal tendency is to turn to God in time of trouble, which we should. We also need to remember to thank Him for the blessings in our daily lives as well. He is in total control each day, and we must remember that. Tom Cutter had a great lesson this morning. And one of the things he talked about was his experience at running and in races and riding in long bike races. And he talked about drafting in a bike race or even in runners, where you pull in behind someone and help you move along. We need to remember that as Christians, that from time to time, we need to get close to others so we can draft on their strength. And there's other times when we need to be the one in the lead and providing that draft for that person that needs that support. Would you bow with me as we begin? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time. We thank you for this opportunity. We can come together and worship you. We thank you for your Son who gave himself for each one of us. We pray that you be with us now throughout this service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. If it's convenient for you, we'll stand for our first two songs.
Christ, we do all adore thee, and we do praise thee forever. Christ, we do all adore thee, and we do praise thee forever. Christ, we do all adore thee. Come, let us all unite to sing, God is love. Let heaven and earth their praises ring, God is love.
Let us all from sin away, each in his heart sweet music play,
and sing with us. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful,
Let us pray. Our God, who is holy and merciful and loving, we thank you for this opportunity we have to come and worship you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your desire to have us come to you and your desire to have us worship you like this. We pray that our worship will be one that will be pleasing to you. Father, we pray for those who lead the service. We pray for Harold that his words will touch our hearts and lead us to follow you more closely. And we pray for the elders here that as they lead us in this, in all that we do, that you'll be with them and guide them and give them the encouragement, and that we can encourage them. We pray that your love for us will show that we love other people, and that our love for each other will bring other people to you. Father, we thank you for all the blessings you give us each day, the forgiveness of our sins, and the hope that one day we'll be living with you. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Let us be
I am in the last week of this week, and Lord willing next week, just teaching sort of a mini-sermon series on what it means to live a courageous life.
And last week we talked about Daniel and living courageously in a pagan world. And today I want to talk about Esther and what she did, how she conducted herself so long ago as a young lady in a faraway place, and you'll see also a person of courage. So I'm so glad you're here today. I'm so glad you joined us, whether you're online or next door in the mask room or here in this auditorium. I'm so grateful for you being here, and I want to say again what Scott said this morning. Tom, you did such a great job in class today. You're such a wonderful teacher. We have had, and I mean this, every Sunday morning has been a different teacher and a different lesson, and they've all been wonderful. And so I appreciate you guys for teaching. We're going to do this next quarter, a different man every morning teaching on the fruit of the Spirit. And so I'm just excited about that. I'm grateful for how many wonderful teachers we have, not only in this auditorium, but downstairs teaching our young people, teaching our teenagers. So thankful for you. So I hope and I pray I'll do a good job this morning teaching from the book of Esther, because Esther is a wonderful book. The story of Esther takes place in the ancient empire of Persia. It is the Persian Mede, if you will, or Medo Empire. The setting is an ancient city called Susa, and Susa is what today is modern-day Iran. The name Esther means star. Did you know that? Esther means star, and she certainly is not the star of this story. There is only one other book of the Bible that is named after a woman. That's the book of Ruth. And in both of those stories, even as wonderful as these women are, the star of their story is God. And you will see that in the book of Esther this morning. She has a Hebrew name by Hadasha. That's what she is called. Her Hebrew name is Hadasha. And I bring that up because that means myrtle or myrtle tree. Some scholars believe that the myrtle tree that was transplanted later on back in Israel, it came from this area, and it has a flower on it that develops into a starburst. And they think that's the connection between Esther and Hadasha being named a star. It's interesting to me, and maybe you already know this, but in the book of Esther, God's name does not appear, not even once. There is no reference to prayer. There is no reference to faith. There is no reference to the law of Moses. No New Testament writer ever quotes the book of Esther. In fact, when they found among the Dead Sea Scrolls many of the old manuscripts, Esther was not uncovered there so long ago in Israel. But to me, that's the beauty of this book. That's the power of the story of the book of Esther. Because you might, in reading this, think God is absent, but he is very much present. His hand is working in providence in the book of Esther, and he's very much a part of this story. And I might add this morning, he's very much a part of your story as well. You might be sitting here this morning or listening to me right now online, and you're thinking, you know what, my life is just so mundane, and I'm just kind of going through the motions, and I really don't have any, I don't stand out, I don't do anything. You know, where is God? And I want to tell you that God is very much a part of your story, and he is working in your life, and you'll see that in the book of Esther, and my prayer is that you'll see that in your life as well. Without the book of Esther, we would not know what it's like back in a culture that they were taken to. What I mean by that is because we have the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, we know what it was like when those that were in captivity went back to Jerusalem, and we know about the rebuilding of the wall, we know about the rebuilding of the temple, we know about what it was like under Zerubbabel, but we don't really know, if not for the book of Esther, we would not know what's taking place back in this Persian area where they had taken. Some 50,000 Jews would be, after 70 years of captivity, some between 50 and 70,000 Jews would return to Jerusalem. Listen to this now, this is very important. 1 million Jews, they estimate, would stay in this area. Some, like Esther, were born there. Esther doesn't know what Jerusalem looks like. She's never been there. Esther was born in captivity. Esther was born far away from home. Esther is unique in the sense that she has no homeland that she's thinking about, in the sense that she needs to get back to Jerusalem. She is born into captivity, and she remains there along with a million other Jews. The more contemporary, the Book of Esther was it was hated and forbidden by the Nazis. The Nazis and the Jews both knew the story of Esther. You read history of what took place in those camps, those death camps, and the Jews would recite some from memory. And it's interesting to hear the children or the grandchildren of people that had to endure that or survive that. They say that their Jewish parents or grandparents could literally quote large portions of the Book of Esther. No wonder they did that. In secret, they would read and quote, they would read to each other the Book of Esther. They were being killed, they were being annihilated, they were being eliminated, and they hung on to what the Nazis and the Jews both knew, and that is, this is a story about God's deliverance and how he would deliver his people. Matthew Henry said of this book, and I quote, "God's name is not in it, but God's hand certainly is in it. You see his fingerprints all over the narrative of this story." Now, here's the truth, as we talk about in just a minute the providence of God and how he works, is that God does not owe us an explanation. He doesn't have to report to us everything that he's doing or that he's going to do, but he is very much in control. He operates a certain way. In fact, Ephesians 4, and I love this verse, says God works all things according to the counsel of his will. Not our will, but the counsel of his will. So the first thing I want you to see this morning is this very, very much is a story of providence. Providence is God taking natural, something very natural to us, and using it supernaturally. He takes the affairs of normal, everyday human life, decisions that people make, maybe even decisions that politicians make, laws that they pass, accidents that seem to happen, and he moves in those things. If you should know this verse, Romans 8:28, he causes all things to work together for good to those that love the Lord, those that love God and are called according to his purpose. Now, when the book of Ruth opens, and hopefully, the book of Esther opens, and you've got your Bible open to the book of Esther now, it opens with the kind of an introduction into the king at this time, Ahasuerus, as we know him. Ahasuerus, the Bible says, it came to pass that Ahasuerus reigned over 127 provinces from India to Ethiopia. Ahasuerus is better known by his Greek name, Xerxes. Xerxes would follow his father, Artaxerxes. You might remember him because Nehemiah, remember, was the cupbearer of his father, King Artaxerxes. Xerxes now is in power. He is referred to in the book of Esther as Ahasuerus. Ahasuerus, one of the things we know about him is he loves to party. He loves a good party. The book opens with a party that takes 6 months. They party for 6 months. Now, let that sink in. And it's followed by a one-week party to thank everyone for helping with the original party. It is not only a 6 months party, but it's on the government's budget that they're partying, and they party for 6 months. And it goes on and on, and then after it's over, it's followed by a week's party. And there's a lot going on now. Scholars believe and historians believe that one of the things that Xerxes or Ahasuerus is trying to do is he is trying to raise money and he is trying to get the morale of the people up. He's trying to raise money to build an army, and he knows he's going to need a massive army to fight what's coming toward him. History tells us that a guy by the name of Philip of Macedon, remember Philip of Macedon has this great army, but more importantly, he's known for his son, who was Alexander, and Alexander thought he was a great guy, and Alexander the Great would eventually take over the world, and so you've got the Persian Empire, the first world government being the Babylonian Empire, then the Medo-Persian, and then the third would be Greece. Listen to what I'm talking about now. I'm talking about the providence of God, God working in natural ways, supernaturally, to set things up to what's to come. Alexander would not only quickly take over the world, but he would leave pockets of the Greek culture all around the world. If you know your history, you know that Alexander would build a road system that was expanded by the Romans, and so they would send out roads all over the empire. Secondly, the Greek English is such a precise English that the two things that were taking place now would set up the gospel to not only be taken to great distances, but it would allow the gospel to be taken in one of the most precise languages ever, the Greek language. That's providence. That's the providence of God. God behind the scenes setting up what I believe are perfect events for the New Testament. Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4, the Bible says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, born of a virgin, born under the law. God knew exactly when to send Jesus into this world. It wasn't a mistake. It wasn't, well, he was born at a different time or a difficult time. He knew exactly when Jesus was going to come into the world, and he had manipulated, if you will, he had allowed all of these events to transpire so that it could be set up. This week, someone told Kay that they had been trying to buy a house in North Georgia, and they finally found a house, and they had put an offer on it, but it was contingent on an inspection. And they said, we've really been praying about this. It really means a lot to us, and we've really been praying about it. But it rained all week long, and we just thought this is the worst thing that could happen to us. It rained with this inspection, and apparently the inspection that took place showed that water was under the house and it was going to flood. It wasn't a good situation, and they said, hey, maybe that wasn't a bad thing after all, was it? We prayed about this and it worked out like this. Sometimes we think these negative events that take place in our life, well, it's just the luck of the draw. It's just the way things happen. And yet we don't know how God is using the events in our life, the people in our life, to bring about the events that he wants to transpire. Now, the following day, this is verses 5 through 7. I'm going to move rapidly through this. There's another feast. It's a seven-day feast. And it's probably to thank, again, the leaders, the palace officials, for throwing the six-month feast. And there's a lot of drinking going on. Verse 9 tells us that there's a queen by the name of Vashti, and she also is having a feast for the women. So there was a banquet going on for the women, banquet going on for the men as well. And so King Ahasuerus, he does something in the middle of this feast, in the middle of this banquet. He decides to show off his wife. She's apparently a trophy wife, and he's going to use her as a trophy. Not only do the Bible tells us, history tells us that Vashti was a very beautiful woman. A lot of people don't know this, but she was the granddaughter of Nebuchadnezzar. So she's the granddaughter of a king. She is now the wife of a king. No doubt she gets pretty much what she wants. And so she says, I'm not going to go. You need to bring the queen here. You need to see exactly what I'm married to. And she says, I'm not going to go. And it sets into a chain of events, the story that we're reading this morning or studying this morning, the story of Esther. Verse 12 says, but Queen Vashti refused to come to the king's command, brought by the eunuchs. Therefore, the king was furious. And of course, we know it doesn't end there. I want to pause and put a parenthesis in here because between chapters 1 and 2, something very important takes place in history that's not mentioned in the Bible. And historically, we know that there is a battle out west called the Battle of Thermopylae. In the Battle of Thermopylae, you may have not ever heard of that battle, but if you've ever heard of the movie 300, it is about the Battle of Thermopylae. In other words, these Spartans, the leader Leonidas, would gather 300 men, Spartans, and he would take a cohort from other armies of Greece, and they would fight the Persians. And they would eventually lose, even though the Persians have very much underestimated the power of these warriors. In fact, history says that one Greek fighter was worth 10 Persian fighters. That's how fierce these guys were, how well trained they were. And what happens eventually, the Persian armies would outflank them and they would defeat them, but they would come back home and they were defeated morally. And so Morale is low. They've underestimated this army that they're fighting against, this enemy that they have, the Greeks. And that's where chapter 2, verse 1 begins. After these things, when the wrath of the king Ahasuerus subsided, he remembers Vashti and what she had done and the decree that had been sent out against her. And so the king's servants who attended him said, let young, beautiful virgins be sought for the king. And this is the first beauty contest, actually, we know about. And, so they decided the king needs to pick a replacement, a beautiful, young replacement for Vashti. And the men in the court, you know, tell, and if you go back and read this, I won't have time to talk about this, but it's interesting. What part of their reasoning is, hey, listen, when other women find out that your wife said no, they might actually follow suit and also say no. You know, a little bit of feminism back then, right? And so they don't want to have any part of that. And so he says, you're exactly right. We're going to have a beauty contest. And we're going to choose a girl to be the next queen. So the Bible tells us in verse 7, Mordecai, this is the family member that's being introduced now into the story. Mordecai has brought up Hadashah. He's helped raise Esther, if you will, his uncle's daughter. The Bible says she had neither father nor mother. The young woman was lovely and beautiful. And, of course, her father and mother, they've died, and Mordecai has taken her under his wing, as though she is his own daughter. Verse 12, that each young woman came to the king Ahasuerus after they completed 12 months of preparation. Real quick, I want to tell you what they did is they prepared these women that were chosen for 12 months. They had to get ready for 12 months. Men, don't ever complain about your wife having to spend an extra hour getting ready. For 12 months, these women got ready. The Bible says 6 months oil and myrrh, 6 months of perfume and preparation. And so it took them about a year before they were presented to the king. Let me just say right here, that God makes each of us, and the Bible does allow for physical beauty. It's okay that you look nice. Many of you are like, I know, thank you very much. I was helping with Vacation Bible School, and this little girl was doing something and just kind of the gymnastic thing, and I said to her, you might need to take gymnastics. You were really good at this. She said, I know I have perfect balance. it's okay to say, you know, you look nice, but not to the neglect of that inner beauty. Peter says, don't let the adornment be merely outward, the arranging of the hair and the wearing of gold and the putting on of fine apparel, but let it be the hidden, that is, person of the heart. And so Esther is chosen queen. She stands out. The Bible says in Esther chapter 2 in verse 17 that the king loved Esther more than all the women, and she found favor and kindness with him more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal turban on her head and made her queen in the place of Vashti. And just like that, a young orphan girl becomes queen in the ruling kingdom of the world at that time. There's a little bit of problem that you need to know about. She's Jewish, but she's kept it a secret. Unlike Daniel last week that we looked at Daniel, they knew where he came from. They knew he came from Jerusalem. They knew he was a Jew. When he talked about his diet, when he talked about his prayer life, when he talked about all these other things, they didn't know this about Vashti. They didn't know this about Mordecai. And this has been kept a secret. She apparently uses her position as queen now to get Mordecai a little bit of a raise and a bump up in position, because we find him now at the gate. He is probably serving in the royal court, and it's there, sitting at the gate in the royal court of the kingdom, that Mordecai hears about a plan to assassinate the king, Xerxes, and he reveals that to Esther, and she reveals it to the king, and those men are taken care of. This is a story of providence. Secondly, it's a story of plotting. This is what Satan does. Satan plots to annihilate groups of people and families and situations, but this really, you're talking about satanic plotting, This is one plot after another, the story of Esther. You can see that. I've already mentioned in Esther chapter 2 and verse 22, the plot that became known to Mordecai. But secondly, there is a plot to kill the Jews. There is a man by the name of Haman now that is introduced in our story. Haman is considered a very wealthy man, and he's also very high in the king's court, as you'll see in a few minutes. But Haman has a problem, and his problem is with Mordecai, and because of that problem, it extends to Mordecai's family and extends to Mordecai's people. In Esther chapter 3 and verse 6, the Bible says, "And he," that is Haman, "considered it beneath his dignity to kill Mordecai alone." Every time Haman would go down the street, people would bow down to him because of his position, but Mordecai did not bow down to him. And so he considered it, the Bible says, beneath his dignity to kill Mordecai alone, for they had told him who the people of Mordecai were. And so Haman sought to annihilate all the Jews and the people of Mordecai that were found throughout the kingdom of Ahasuerus. Chapter 3, verse 1, "After these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman." Haman, the Bible says, is an Agagite, not a very nice word. In fact, many times the Bible talks about Haman, it wants you to know he is an Agagite. Do you know why? Why would the Holy Spirit want you to know that Haman is an Agagite? I don't know either. No, I'm just kidding. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, Saul is sent out by God to annihilate the Amalekites. Do you remember this story? And God said, "Hey, listen, go take care of the Amalekites. They're trying to annihilate the Jews. They're trying to kill all the Jews." So Saul goes out. Do you remember this story? He goes out, and instead he thinks, this is more guidelines than really commands, or, you know, I'm just going to go out. Remember, he brings back cattle and sheep, you know, to sacrifice. But he also, when he comes back, he brings some people with him. And Samuel meets him, the Bible says, and he said, "Did you do what God told you to do?" And he said, "Well, I didn't really kill everybody. I brought some with me." And he said, What is the bleeding of sheep and the mooing of cows? "And who is this King Agag?" And he said, "Well, I brought him here as a prisoner." And before he could even get another thing out of his mouth, Samuel takes out his sword and hacks King Agag to death. Don't mess with Samuel. And so in that story, what you find out is the Amalekites have some people escape. They're saved from annihilation. And had Saul done what he was commanded to do in the first place, Haman would have never been a problem in the story of the book of Esther. And it is a story of how far-reaching disobedience really is. Haman decides to act. In verse 6, the Bible says that he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, and so he decides to lay hands on the people, of course, of Mordecai. Haman decides to destroy not one man, but all Jews, to annihilate, remember what I told you at the beginning of this lesson, 1 million people he will commit genocide of the Jewish nation. Verse 9, Haman said, "If it pleases the king, let a decree be written and that they be destroyed. I'll pay 10,000 talents of silver." Where is he going to come up with this money? This is one-third of the king's treasury. Where is he going to come up with 10,000 talents? He doesn't have that. And the answer is, after he kills all these people, he's going to plunder and he's going to take what belongs to them and he's going to use that money and give it back to the king. Remember, low financially, low militarily, low moral, the morale is gone down. They've been defeated in war, and if they can eliminate this group of people, then it will help build the kingdom once again. So Haman sends letters, the Bible says, and he has the king's signet ring on those letters. And it puts the authority given that needs to be given to them for 127 providences on a certain date that all the Jews will be eliminated. And just like that, you see the strategy going out. Now, God has promised already in the Bible that he's going to protect the seed of the woman, and that through this woman, through this nation, is going to come a Messiah. And one of the ways that you would kill the Messiah is you would kill the nation that he would come from. This is Satan's attempt always to overthrow the promises of God, and it never works. This is chapter 4, verse 1. Then Mordecai learned that all that had happened, he tore his clothes, he put on sackcloth and ashes on his head, and he went out into the midst of the city, and he cried out loud in a bitter cry. So he hears about the destruction of the Jews, his people, and him, and he goes out and he begins to lament and cry and grieve over this. Esther hears about this. She doesn't understand it completely, and she sends clothes to him and tries to find out exactly what's going on. This is chapter 4 and verse 13. Mordecai, he tells the servants of the queen, he says, "You go and answer Esther, do not think in your heart that you will escape the king's palace any more than all the other Jews. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise from the Jews from another place." One, I think, of the most significant phrase in all the Bible, especially in the story of Esther, is, he says, one of the best phrase is, he says, "Yet who knows that you have not come unto the kingdom for such a time as this." Now, if your father's house is going to perish if you don't step up and say something. Now, remember, I told you that God is not mentioned in this book, but I believe in this verse he certainly applied. In other words, God's going to raise up someone else. If he's not going to use you, then he's going to make sure that his people are delivered. And so I believe these are fateful words of a man that isn't so fateful. That is Mordecai. He's a little bit backslidden because he's hiding. And he told Esther to hide the fact that she was a Jew. But he knew the promises of God. Genesis chapter 12, "I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you." Genesis 15, "I'll make your descendants like the stars of the heaven in the sands of the earth." He knew that God made a covenant with the Jewish people and that he was convinced by faith that God was going to deliver them. He could use Esther to deliver them, but if she didn't want to do it, then he was going to raise up someone else who would bring about that deliverance. And who knows that maybe you're not queen for such a time as this. When I read that phrase, I always think about this. This is your time. Who knows that for such a time as this, you are in the neighborhood that you live in. You are on the job that you have. For such a time as this, you have the family that you have. God has placed you exactly where he wants you in a time like this. Now, he can raise somebody else to do what he wants you to do, but he will use you if you allow him to do that in his providence, and he will protect you all along. Esther's response in verse 16 is awesome. "Go gather all the Jews who are present at Shushan and fast for me." Notice she doesn't say pray, but I also believe this is a spiritual thing. Rarely do you hear about fasting that you don't hear about praying. And so they gather all the Jews who were present at Susan, "Fast for me, neither let them eat or drink in 3 days, 3 nights, my maids and I will fast likewise, and I'll go to the king, which is against the law, and if I perish, and I'll perish." Why was it against the law? Why was it against the law for her? She's the queen. Why was it against the law? Now, antiquity, history tells us that these kings would isolate themselves mostly for security. Already we've seen case in point in the book of Esther about two men trying to plot and kill the king. So they would withdraw even from the queen and anyone else that would try to poison them. That's why Nehemiah was the cupbearer. He didn't want anyone to kill the king. They were always withdrawn. They were apart from other people, and they would protect themselves. And so if she came into the presence of the king and he didn't lift his scepter and allow her in, then her head was off. She was going to die. But I love her logic thinking. What she's thinking is, hey, if I go see the king, I might die. If I stay and I don't say nothing, I'm going to die. I need to do the right thing and go talk to the king. And if I die, I die, but at least I'm going to die doing the right thing. It is what Daniel did last week. It is what Esther does this week, and it's what you and I need to do every week to draw a line in the sand and say, I'm going to do the right thing. I'm going to do the right thing today, and I'm going to do the right thing tomorrow, and I'm going to do the right thing the next day. Even if it brings hurt and heartache to my life, I'm going to do the right thing. And so her thinking is logical Real quick, and I've got one more point, and I'll wrap it up, but I want to give you a few examples of this. How do you get a Jewish couple living in Nazareth to go to Bethlehem? Prophecy, the Bible says, that the Messiah was going to be born in Bethlehem. That's Micah 5 and verse 2. For God, that's no problem. He uses providence. In fact, what he does is he takes the king and he has him allow people to go back to their tribal homes, their ancestral towns, if you will, and across the land. And because of this registration, it forces a young couple, they're pregnant with their first child, and their name is Joseph and Mary. And because of this edict, they are sent back from a faraway place back into Bethlehem, and Jesus would be born exactly where God wanted to be born, according to Micah chapter 5 and verse 2, which was written 700 years before the birth of Christ. What do you do? How do you get a preacher to go to Rome? How do you get a preacher to stand before a king and go to Rome to get the gospel to go to a lost and dying world? What you do is you take a guy that was born a Jew, who's also a Roman citizen, you strike him down blind on the Damascus Road, and you take old Saul of Tarsus and you allow him to become the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul would be put on a grain ship, and he would be taken to Rome to stand before kings, and from that moment on, the gospel would be taken to the rest of the known world. There's another problem. How do you protect the Jews that you're trying to protect from a famine? They're hungry and they're dying because they're so hungry. Well, what you do is you take a guy by the name of Joseph and you have his brothers sell him out. You have Potiphar sell him out. He ends up in prison. He listens to the dreams of people and he interprets them, rising only second to Pharaoh, and he would allow, because of Pharaoh's dreams, the Jews to live for 7 years of that famine. They would prosper, and not only would he look out for his own personal family, he would look out for an entire nation. That's how God works. He works in providence, and he is working in your life. Esther chapter 5 and verse 2, and so she found favor in his sight. King didn't kill her. He raised a scepter. In fact, the Bible says he said, hey, what do you want? I'll give you half the kingdom. Man, I'll tell you what, Esther was pretty powerful influence, right, on the king. He said, I'll give you half. So not only does he not kill her, he wants to give her something. And she says, well, I'd like a banquet. And in this banquet, I'd like Haman to be brought to this banquet, and we're going to have this dinner together in your presence. This is a rare thing. Rarely would a king, especially one who's already had a problem with his wife probably, do this kind of thing. This just shows you how much power she has. He said, I'll do exactly what you want me to do. We'll have a dinner with Haman. Haman, he leaves. Man, the king wants to eat dinner with me. The queen wants to eat dinner with me. This is awesome. And so he leaves, he's stoked, and he's going to have a party with the king. And the Bible says in verse 9 of chapter 5 that Haman went out that day joyful. He was glad of heart. And Haman saw Mordecai sitting at the gate, the king's gate, and he did not stand, nor did he tremble before him. And he was filled with indignation and hate for Mordecai. He goes home and he whines. Can you imagine, like so many people today, they have everything. They got money, they got homes, they got cars, he's got everything. But he can't get past this one guy, this one thing. And because of that, his wife said, here's what you're going to do. You're going to hang him, put him on gallows. There's kind of a misrepresentation in the translation of that word. Your Bible might say gallows. Literally what they did is they put people on poles. They impaled them on poles. This was where crucifixion would eventually come from. They would take a pole and they would put someone on it, and they, dead or alive, they would parade him through the city or leave him on a housetop. These were the Persians who would later invent crucifixion, and they would raise somebody up on a pole. One last thing, and I'll be done. This is a story of protection. Not only is it a story of plotting, and not only is it a story of providence, it's a story of protection. I love this story today. I love this story with everybody. We're just trying to do our best to stay safe. I'll be honest with you, I turn on television, I turn on the internet, and I read the stories, and There's so much fear out there. Hey, this, there's one variant coming along. Now they're saying there's a doomsday variant. God, can you get any more ominous wording than a doomsday variant coming to us, y'all? And I say all that not to belittle what's going on, but to say, have we forgotten that God in providence is helping us, that he hasn't lost any of his power, and he is going to help protect us? And I think as we do the right thing and send the gospel into a lost and dying world and think less about ourselves and more about other people, then he's going to help us and he's going to protect us. Chapter 6 and verse 1, the Bible says that the king couldn't sleep. God even will use insomnia for his glory. He couldn't sleep and he wanted to bring in books being read to him. They were the history books of what happened to the kingdom. If you have problems sleeping, this would probably put you right out. Things that went out to the gate, had someone a couple of years ago said, I have a hard time sleeping, and sometimes I listen to your lessons at night, and it really helps calm me down. I didn't know how to take that. So they read this to the king, and they read, y'all, this is no mistake. This is no mistake. What do they read about? They read about Mordecai. They read about Mordecai saving the king's life. And the king goes, wait a minute. I remember this. Esther told me about this. We hung those two guys. I remember this story. Whatever happened to that guy? What was done for that guy? They said, nothing. And he said, well, I'm going to have something done for him. Who's out in the court right now? You know who's out in the court? Haman. He brings Haman in. Haman, if you were going to honor someone, and Haman's thinking, hey, they're talking about me. He's talking about me. If you're going to honor someone, what would you do? Man, Haman, he knew exactly. And this kind of shows you where Haman's head at, because it was all about being noticed. Well, I put him on a horse. I put a robe on him. I'd parade him through the streets. Haman knew exactly what needed to be done. And can you imagine the blood draining out of Haman's face when the king said, hey, go get Mordecai and do all of these things to him and for him, and don't leave any of these things undone. Can you imagine what he had to do? And then it's time for the king's feast, and Esther would tell the king in chapter 7 and verse 2 what he does not know yet, and that is about her Jewish heritage, and she's about ready to drop the bomb. Haman doesn't know it. The king doesn't know it. No one except Mordecai and a few others know it. And she drops the bomb in chapter 7 and verse 3. King Esther answered and said, if I have found favor in your sight, O king, if it pleases the king, let my life be given to me at petition, my people, at my request, and my people, for they have been sold, and my people and I will be destroyed and be killed. We will be annihilated, and we've been sold as male and female slaves. I would have held my tongue, although the enemy would never compensate for the king's loss. Ahasuerus says, wait a minute. Who did all this? Who's planning all this? And she says, your adversary, the enemy, the wicked king Haman. And so Haman, of course, the Bible says he's terrified. The king gets up, and he's probably collecting himself. He gets up, and he walks out into the court. And when he comes back, Haman has thrown himself somehow at Esther's feet. The Bible says he's leaning toward her. And that really ticks the king off. Not only has he plotted to kill him, but it looks like he's trying to put himself on top of the queen, and he's not going to have any part of that. And he uses, as you know the story, the very gallows that Haman has made to kill Mordecai are used to take his life. And God's providence is once again seen. There's a major problem when you come to the end of the book of Esther, and that is because the king had put his signet ring on the death of all of those Jews. How do you say, well, I made a mistake? Because they didn't make mistakes. They could not allow this to be recalled. This was the law of the Medes and the Persians meant when the king's signet ring went on it, it had to be done. And the king does something very unusual, and it's really pretty cool. What he does is he sends out a second decree in all of the kingdom, and he gives the right to the Jews to defend themselves against anyone that will attack them, and they do. They take care of Haman's sons and his family. They take care of anyone that is going to come against them. And the Jews, not only are the Jews victorious, But the Bible actually tells us because of them, many of the people there in that faraway place convert to Judaism. They become Jews. They become part of their family. In order to do that, you have to claim that God is the God of Israel. Even though you weren't born a Jew, if you were going to become a Jew like this, a proselyte Jew, then you had to claim that God is the God of Israel. And the Bible tells us in the book of Esther that many of them acknowledged the God of Israel and became Jews. Now, let's don't make a mistake of God's silence or his absence. In the story of Esther, God, he chooses to save people in an ordinary way. There's no parting of the Red Sea. There is no resurrection, so to speak. There is no miraculous, and so many times we look for God in the miraculous, and he is working in the ordinary. And that's how God does. He turns our life on the hinges of providence and in the ordinary. And I think also you see a picture of God, even though he's not mentioned in the story of Esther. I think you see this picture of God, that you can't come to the King of Kings. You just can't come into his presence. Not anyone can come into his presence. And that it's because of what Jesus did on the cross so long ago that allows us to come boldly before the throne of God. It's because Jesus shed his blood on the cross at Calvary that the king would raise his scepter and say, you're part of my family, you're part of the providence that I have in your life, and you're also going to be under my protection because you're part of my kingdom. It doesn't matter what you've done or how far you've gone. God can take, so long ago, a little girl. She was probably a teenager, and she didn't have a mom or a dad. She was orphaned. Mordecai was actually her cousin that looked after her. And he would take her and make her queen, and she would save the Jews. And while Nehemiah and others were building the wall of Jerusalem, rebuilding the walls around Jerusalem and the temple, there was a young girl who had become queen that was really a part of saving a million people or maybe more because God put her exactly where he wanted her. It is an awesome story of God's providence and that we can see him working not only in her life, but I want you to see him working in your life. So many times what happens is it's when we look back on stuff, right? Oh, man, I could see how God did that. I can see how he worked that out. What I want to challenge us today is, even though we're going through it by faith, almost like what Mordecai did, listen, God's going to deliver us. God's going to take care of us. He knows exactly what's going on by faith. We can't see how he's going to do it, but by faith we know that God is going to do what we could never do. It is a powerful story, and I think it helps every single one of us become courageous. Our song this morning of encouragement is I Am Coming, Lord, and of course it is an invitation for all of us who are outside of Christ and who want to become a child of the King, that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, willing to confess him, willing to repent, willing to turn away from that sin and be baptized into Christ and raised to walk in a brand new life. Maybe some of you have already done that, but you're not living like a child of the King. I just want to remind you this morning of God's providence in your life, of God, how Satan will always be plotting against you. But guess what? Just as he moves maybe a Haman against you, he also will move a queen for you. It's interesting how we'll maybe look back on our life, even these moments right now, and say, isn't it amazing how God was working all of that out to put us in this moment, in this time, in this place, and to use us for his glory, not our own. See him in your story. He's very much a part of your story. And if he's not, accept him today, invite him today as a part of your story. Allow yourself to put on the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus by being baptized into Christ, or come back to him. He loves you. I'll be here at the front. If I can help you in any way, you come, while we stand and sing this song of encouragement. day this is, and that Holly Haney has come forward to the invitation. She's a nurse that works with Paul Beck, and she wants to be baptized into Christ today. And so we're rejoicing and so happy about it. I'm going to help Paul. I'll help you back here, okay? And Kay, if you will help Holly and them, and we'll get to witness that together. Let's say a prayer together. Father, we're thankful today for Holly, for her willingness to come and to give her life to you, to identify with your death, burial, and resurrection, and to be raised to walk in a new life, to have heaven as her home, to have her name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. How grateful we are to rejoice with the angels in heaven that are rejoicing today at Holly's decision to give her life to you. We thank you, Lord, for bringing her here at this moment, at this day, on this time. And we don't think it's by accident or fate that you worked all of that out for us to be a part of it, for us to witness it. And so we're grateful for that today. See your hand working in all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
While they prepare, we'll Dwight Austin gave me a note, and it says, please pray for my cousin Shamika Moore's family. She passed away this past week suddenly. She was a mother of 12 children, the youngest of which was 3 years old, and the older ones in their 20s. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we pray that you would be with Shamika's family. We pray that you would bless them and comfort them. Father, we pray that you would be with those around them, that they might be able to comfort them and know that your love is there with them. I pray that you'd be with Dwight and his family, that they might be able to love and support them. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I ask you to take a song book and turn to 714. 714. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word,
for they say
117, Victory in Jesus, if you want to keep your finger there. 717.
Faith comes from hearing, hearing by the words of Christ, Romans 10:17. We also know that God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life, John 3:16. And we know about repentance. It was so important that Jesus said in Luke 13:3, unless you repent, you shall likewise perish. And then we know that we must confess. And I'm going to ask for your confession and your faith. Jesus says, if you confess me before the men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. If you deny me before the men, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. Then we know in the Great Commission says, Jesus says, go to all nations, teach the good news. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. In Acts 2:38, Peter says, repent. Let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. In Romans 6:3-4, you'll be buried with Christ in baptism. You're going to raise a new creation. Everything you've ever done, Holly, will be forgiven. That's when we reach the blood of Christ. So, Holly, I'm going to ask you, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory,
how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
We'll sing Hallelujah, What a Savior as we begin to prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Bearing shame and scoffing bruise.
This morning in Bible class, Tom was talking about getting off course and compared it to a race. And he and I hiked the Appalachian Trail every year now for the past few years, and they have these white blazes on the trees and rocks and things so that as you go, every so often you see one, you know you're on the right track. You don't get lost. And I don't know how we did it, but somehow we managed to get off track last year. And I think both of us realized it sooner or later, but I just remember we're going straight up a hill, walking on gravel, so it's not even, you know, soft surface or anything, and the sun's just beating down on us both, and both of us are, hey, have you seen a blaze lately? No. And we get there to the top of this hill, and luckily we ran into a guy who somehow we had looped completely around back to where we started the day out, and he said, oh, you just go down this hill, you'll be where you need to be. Okay, so, you know, it's like 3 hours that we were off track. And, you know, it was hard and it hurt and it was frustrating. I think about stories like Esther. You know, that wasn't 3 hours. That was days, months, years. I think about, you know, you mentioned the Nazis. They were in power for over 20 years. I mean, think about standing there thinking, where is God? I'm dealing with this right now. In the Old Testament, he gave us the Passover. He gave the Jews the Passover. So that every year, they knew where God was. They remembered. He led us out of Egypt. He led us out of captivity. They were in Egypt for 400 years. But he led them out. In Luke 22, is where I'll be reading. But it's in every gospel except for John. He gave us something else to remember. And I tell you what, I've been a Christian for over 2 decades, some of you much longer than me. I get tired sometimes. I get frustrated. The whole world seems against us sometimes. And this is the second or third time I've gotten to privilege of being up here after someone's baptized, and what a blessing that is to see, because it's like a new birth, it's like a new start, and all that frustration that I have, man, somebody's listening, it's working, it's spreading, what a blessing that is. But we have something every week. So I don't know about you, but the further from Sunday I get, the more frustrated I get. Well, I come back, and every week I've got something to bring me back and to remind me that God is with us. In Luke 22, starting in verse 14, when the hour had come, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I say to you, I shall never eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken the cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves, for I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. And when he had taken some of the bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after eating, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. And that's what we're here right now to do. If you haven't already, I believe we have the cups and bread at the back. Make sure you get one of those. But right now, we're going to go ahead and pray for the bread. Lord God Almighty, we love you. We thank you so much for the church, that we can come, that we can be a part of like-minded people struggling to find you and seeking after your path. And we thank you so much for your son that you allowed to die on a cross for us so that we can be with you. As we take this bread, which is the body broken for us, we pray that we do it in a manner pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Pray with me again, please. Lord, again, we thank you so much for the sacrifice, for the blood shed on our behalf, the blood that covers our sins, the perfect sacrifice for us. So that even though we're flawed, even though we're sinful, we have a path of repentance to stand before your throne as righteous and as clean. As we take this fruit of the cup, or the cup, the fruit of the vine, we pray that we do it in a pleasing way to you. In Jesus' name, amen. This time also, we'll now have a time to give back. Still not passing the plates around, but there's ways to give online. You can mail a check to the church as well. You can hand it to Lloyd, I'm sure, as well. But I'm trying to get there, sorry. 1 Corinthians 16, concerning the collection for the saints, as I directed the churches of Galatia, so do you. On the first day of the week, let each of you lay by in store, or put aside and save, as he may prosper, so that no collections be made when I come. So this is a command, give back every week as you've been prospered. That's why we do this. I think about, you know, you look around the world right now. I try to not read the news because it depresses me, but you can't miss it. You're blessed here. As hard as it may seem, as you know, you think about lockdowns and all this stuff going on, whether you agree with it or not, it's a lot easier than being in a desert in Afghanistan right now. We are a blessed people, and we need to remember that and think about it. And as we give back, you know, it's not just a ritual. I mean, this money's going to help people. And so that's why we're giving it. But pray with me, please. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that we have. We pray that we recognize it and realize it, that we are blessed, and use those blessings to help others. And be with the elders as they allocate these funds and use them, and help them to use it wisely and in ways that maximize the benefit for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Again, we're thankful for you being here this morning, grateful you're here to worship with us. Thank you, Harold, for another great lesson this morning. We'll stand together and sing two verses of a closing song then, if you will be seated after the closing prayer, and Scott will have a few more announcements for us. Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today and a new week to glorify you. Thank you for the many blessings we have, and thank you for Harold's lesson that we received this morning, and help us to go throughout this week living it out. Thank you for our new sister in Christ as well, and please be with those around us who are suffering and mourning. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.